Hello, good afternoon, and welcome to Bengaluru, India. This is the FIBA Women's Asia Cup 2019, and we are tipping things off here in Group B with Australia and the Philippines. So Australia have returned to the scene where they had such a wonderful first experience at the FIBA Women's Asia Cup 2 years ago, until they got to the final where they lost to Japan. You can see they are starting things off today. Also, Korea, Chinese Taipei will follow, then China, New Zealand, and we'll wrap things up tonight with Japan against hosts India. Well, Philippines and Australia were on the bench. Just to say, I'm Jeff Taylor, joined by Mark Mills. And Mark, straight from the World Cup in China to Bengaluru, India. It's good to see you. And I think we have an idea how this tournament's going to go, but you got to play the games.
Yeah, absolutely. It's one of those where you're looking at it and you're thinking, yeah, I'm pretty sure who's going to be in the final four, who should be in the final, but this is why we love the sport. You just don't really know who's going to make it through. We're likely to see a shock, and we're likely to see a new superstar be born in this tournament.
Well, one thing we do know is that when Australia was added to Asia, they immediately became the team to beat. They won the World Cup, the FIBA Basketball Women's World Cup, back in 2006. And really, for the past two decades, they have been an elite team in women's basketball. The Philippines, clearly basketball is the number one sport in that country. And the aim is to get the women's team playing at a high level. The men have obviously made a lot of headlines over the years. They did not have a good World Cup this year. But nevertheless, basketball very important, and will host the men's World Cup in 2023. The women, they want to steal some of the spotlight. And boy, would they ever if they came out with a solid performance today against a heavily favored Australia team.
Oh, yeah, the Philippines are massively underdogs in this game, you know, and you're going to see why, just the sheer size of the Australian team in comparison to the Philippines team. But potentially that could play to their advantage if they're smart and they're, you know, they're quick about the game, use that speed advantage that they've got over the Australian team, move the ball quickly, move themselves quickly. They've got a chance to cause an upset.
Well, Australia just 1 year ago actually beaten by the USA in the final of the FIBA Women's Basketball World Cup in Tenerife. They have not got Liz Cambage this summer. However, one thing you would have to say about Australia is it is a country that has tons of players, and they can often replace like for like. I would suggest that Liz Cambage is irreplaceable in that sense. But nevertheless, they don't have a shortage of talent.
No, they certainly have strength in numbers. Obviously, replacing a player, you know, of that stature, not just physically, but what she brings to the court as well, is going to be difficult. But they are returning six players from that World Cup squad here to the Asia Cup. So they've got consistency. You know, they've got a team that know each other.
So Sandy Brondello, also one of the all-time great Australians, is the coach. And we're going to have a pause in the commentary for the playing of the national anthems. Thank you. Always a good part here in the national anthems, just as a reminder of what this is all about, playing for the national teams, playing for the countries. And there's no greater honor, I know, down under than putting on the green and gold and playing for them, and same in the Philippines. So players have shaken hands, and now they're going to go through their final warm-ups, and so the referees getting into position. And there they are. They will be adjudicating matters today. So they take their customary spot at midcourt, and they will be calling the shots. So we will hopefully at some point be able to give you some more information. But as you look at the referees, and then we look at get ready to see the final warm-ups of these teams, the Philippines, yeah, they are in the role of David today against Goliath.
Oh, massively. They're ranked 47th in the world, 9th in the Asia region, going up against Australia, who are ranked 3rd in the world and 1st in the Asia region. There doesn't come much bigger challenge for the Philippines, and it's the opening day for them. So the one bonus they can take is things are only going to get easier.
Well, Patrick Aquino's team, who stands out for you?
Well, looking through the team, there's obviously a fair amount of experience looking through the Filipino side. I think the one that I'm excited to look for is Kelly Hayes and see what impact she's going to have in today's game.
Well, she's interesting. They're going to come off the bench today, but there's been a lot of talk about her. It's going to be Bernardino, Cabin Ben, Pontejos in that starting five that will be logging big minutes. Miranda as well. And we got to be fast with those, Mark.
We do. We do. The graphics come thick and fast, that's for sure.
And Ezzie McBagger there, we spoke about her earlier. She's a huge talent in this Australia team, coached by Sandy Brondello.
Yeah, it's keen for both McBagger and probably Blikavs to get in there and get started early. They're going to really be a big difference, and how much pressure they put on the Philippines will be really critical.
So it's going to be Jen O'Hay, Leilani Mitchell, Beck Allen, Katie Ebsery, and Kayla George in that starting five. Of course, Kayla George, one of the more experienced players in this team, and Katie Ebsery played in this event and also played at the World Cup and is a very important part of things in that backcourt. So she will, I would suggest, defensively really try to set the tone for Australia. I know she struggled, as did some of the other Australians, offensively at the World Cup, but it's the defense is where things have to work for Australia if they're going to play their style of basketball. And they, no doubt, Brondella's going with a team that is going to get after the Philippines.
Yeah, absolutely. They're going to set their stall out on the defensive end. They're going to want to make sure that they, you know, limit the Philippines to as few points as possible and make their journey through to game day two as easy as possible. Last time these two met, it was a 42-point win for Australia. You'd imagine Australia are kind of setting that maybe as their benchmark for this. It's for the Philippines to come and cause the upset.
Never, never give up. Laban lang, laban ng laban, ha? Takbo tayo, kumakatakbo tayo, takbo tayo, ha? Takbo tayo, okay? Clear? Ha? Suma, Chucky.
So Patrick Aquino, the coach, final words offered here to his team. And also Sandy Brondello there in the middle. One of the interesting stories of Australian basketball over the years was a wonderful player, obviously has gone on and coached in America and the WNBA. She's really got a relaxed demeanor with this team. I thought she did a great job last year at the World Cup.
Yeah, she's definitely a really critical part of the team for Australia, and I think she has so much respect from the players for what she achieved as a player. Obviously, you know, she's part of the Australian Hall of Fame as well. Back in 2010, she was inaugurated into that. So there really isn't much of a bigger name in Australian women's basketball than Sandy Brondello.
Well, they got so many big names when you think about it, really. Kirstie Herrer, Lauren Jackson, Penny Taylor,
Sandy Brook, Michelle Timms. I mean, it's like a who's who's.
Yeah, it really is.
You talk about the Australian Hall of Fame, Basketball Hall of Fame. That is a serious Basketball Hall of Fame.
Yeah, it's bursting at the seams, and it's only going to get fuller and fuller the way things are going for both the men's and the women's team.
Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, wherever you're watching. We are in Bengaluru, India, and this is the start of the FIBA Women's Asia Cup 2019, the same venue that hosted this event 2 years ago. And already Kayla George and Australia getting an easy look down low to take the early lead.
Yeah, the Philippines will have to lock down on the defensive end. They're going to have to help so hard in the front court. They can't just leave it straight up defense.
Bernardino out on the perimeter. She's going to launch a three, and Janelle Hayes going to come up with the first rebound. Now Mitchell over to Ebzeri. Back Allen. And Ebzeri gets it back. Now down low to Kayla George.
That's a good job by Anaman. She needs to get that confidence on the defensive end. She needs to know that she can compete and she can really limit what the Australians can do in the paint.
Gabby Ben passes it over to Anaman, who drives in and banks it in right at the end of the shot clock. That's a dream possession for the Philippines.
Yeah, couldn't come much better than that.
But quickly to the other end. And great running the floor there was Jenna O'Hay. She's fouled, so she will go to the line for two.
And that's a crime for the Philippines. This is going to be key for them. They're going to have to make sure that their transition defense and offense is absolutely fully on track. They can't afford to give away easy points like that. They're going to have to fight for every possession.
So I believe the foul was actually on Anaman. Now they want to clarify that. Said Ebzeri in the graphic, but it's I think it's on number 10. It is, so that's her first foul. And one of the more accomplished Opals at the line, the captain Jenna O'Hay, who had a, I would say, suggest, difficult World Cup just because of injury, kind of kept her off the court for much of that event. And here she is coming out strong today. Philippines launch one from deep and miss pretty much everything. Falls right to Beck Allen. Now Ebzeri. Back to Beck Allen. And front and back of the rim and stays out. And a hold was called on Anaman. That's her second.
Yeah, and this is the problem they're going to get. The Filipino team is not a big team. They can't afford for the two or three, you know, competitive post defenders that they've got to get into early foul trouble.
Easy one for Allen, and it is going to be a long day at the office for the Philippines if they give up layups to this Australia team. Mitchell almost forcing the turnover. Philippines get it back, and a foul called in the lane. I think it's on O'Hay.
Yeah, I like that move by Miranda, though. She's been positive, she's been direct, and sometimes when you're the underdog, you almost have to take the fight to the other team. You can't shy away from the fact that you are the underdog, and as you see the drive to the basket, she's done exactly the right thing. She's drawn the foul, she's drawn the contact, and she just needs to convert from the line.
Australia on top. And Australia turning it back over to the Philippines.
It's already turning into a nice, interesting battle between Anaman and George. And The Filipino player had the upper hand in that one, but you have a feeling that's going to be a battle that goes for pretty much the 40 minutes.
And a bump and good drive. Now Leilani Mitchell. Mitchell down to O'Hay and goes hard to the basket and a little bit of contact, so she will go to the line.
And this is the problem the Philippines have now. They need to make a decision early. Whoever's defending in that low post, because they're going to mismatch against them. Australia are going to put their guards into the low post as well. Are they helping across? Because if they are, the help needs to come an awful lot quicker than that. And also they need to decide, is the help coming down or is it coming across? Because they got to a treble team situation then. So even if they were able to lock her down, so many players open for O'Hay to pass out to.
Hey, bends the knees and drills it and takes it up to an 8-3 advantage for the Opals. And now a little bit of full court pressure and forcing the turnover.
Yeah, it's great defense by Australia. They've already tried a couple of different press zones and a little bit more of a man-to-man and a double. The Philippines will need to deal with that pressure, otherwise it could be blown out quite easily and quite early.
Now Mitchell penetrates, puts it up and banks it in. And Australia off and running here. 10-3. Bernardino drives and contact called on Beck Allen. So free throws coming. And again, for the second time, the Philippines rewarded for attacking the basket.
Yeah, and it's the right thing to do when you're in this situation. Try and draw some fouls, try and draw some contact, get your score rolling from the free throw line. But that move by Leilani Mitchell, it was all on that first crossover at the top. She just got a player onto the wrong foot, and it doesn't matter that she's undersized, she's over-talented.
First free throw good. Blitzovs is going to check into the game. For Australia, the next opportunity. The second one no good, and Kayla George comes up with a rebound. Now Edzeri pulls up, little mid-range, and Beck Allen rebounds that miss. Kayla George launches it from the arc and drills it. Well, that's one thing the Philippines are going to struggle on the boards. Give away offensive rebounds, that's not a good thing, but pulling up on the break herself is Miranda. Now Edzeri, beautiful bounce pass to Allen.
A wonderful fluid basketball from both teams at the moment. The tempo of the game's just gone up. And I'm enjoying what the Philippines are doing. They're not backing away from the challenge. They're going straight out. And the issue they've got at the moment is their transition defense is way too slow.
Bounce pass themselves into Bernardino. She misses but follows. And Kayla George then rebounds that second miss. Edzeri outside to Mitchell. Kayla George, another offensive rebound and putback for Kayla George. Could be off to a big afternoon here in Bengaluru.
Now, I'm not sure what defensive system Coach Aquino is running at the moment, but the Filipino players seem a little bit lost. They're not sure where their assignments are, where they should be helping, where they shouldn't be.
Well, answering number 28, Miranda. Pass up to Allen now. She's cut off. Now O'Hay back to Allen. And Animan has just picked up her third foul. And the game is only 4.5 minutes old.
That causes the Philippines a huge amount of trouble. They're going to bring Danica Jose in, but Animan really is their key post defender.
And we'll also get our first look at Kelly Hayes. So good job for George. She goes to the bench as well as O'Hay, Mitchell. Mike Beggar has come in as well as Blitzavs. And Australia's number 35, Nicole Seacamp. There's Blitzavs
Bounce pass, beautiful play. Opals, the finish wasn't there, but they get it back, as has been the case all day. And Allen drills it. How about that?
Yeah, another big shot. Allen up to 7 points now, and the Australians are just starting to warm up. You feel them starting to warm up, and they've not dropped the tempo, even though they've made quite a few changes early on.
A quick drive, and Pontejos takes a little shot. Now Ebsery gets it to Blitzives, who misses. Seacamp over to Allen. She says, I like this spot. Misses, but Blitzives with the offensive rebound. Gets it back to Allen. And now Seacamp. McBeggar goes baseline. This is everything, but again, this time it was Kaylee Hayes fails to pick up the loose ball. And for some reason, they did not reset the shot clock. So we heard the buzzer. Pontejos reaches in, Ebsery to Allen. And Allen says, chalk up another 2 points for me, please.
Yeah, Australia really in fine form, and you're seeing every single player touching the ball, every single player dynamic and moving.
Cabin bin. Ah, had a very makeable layup. Now Ebsery attacks and hands it off, and Blitzives is fouled by Pontejos.
And that's the right move by Pontejos. You need to stop some momentum at the moment. Australia in full flow, and you'd rather just slow the game down, try and hit a little bit of a reset button on the floor, and the foul sometimes can enable you to do that.
So we've got a timeout on the floor as you look at Beck Allen's latest hoop. She's hooping and scooping along with all the other Opals, and they lead by 13 points. And we're not even 6 minutes into the contest. So we'll go down to the Filipino huddle and listen in to Coach Aquino.
Nobody's gonna shoot from down here. Everybody's gonna shoot from down here. You gotta get down.
Okay, I think we're actually listening to the Australians. Unless Aquino has an Australian accent. I don't think that's the case. Australia, 8 of 18 from the floor. Philippines, 3 of 10. And, you know, you almost anticipate the way this game is going to go. But look at the three-point shooting as well. Australia have a couple makes. Philippines, 1. Maybe for the Philippines, you can do a little bit better, you know, cleaning up, you know, grabbing some defensive boards and also miss, you know, making a couple more shots. Makeable shots. They almost need to play perfect basketball to keep this game close.
Yeah, they will do. The thing you've got is, in straight away, the stat that jumps out to you from, you know, you've just read it out. Australia have almost had twice as many shot attempts as the Philippines have, and it's all on the back of their offensive rebounding. 9 offensive rebounds for Australia, and we're not even 6 minutes into the game. The Philippines can't let that continue. They might even be better dropping into a zone defense, giving up some perimeter shots, but defending their boards.
Well, Steph Talbot checks in and takes a knee immediately to the thigh. Welcome to the game. Here's Kaylee Hayes driving and denied by McBeggar, and then the underside of the backboard. Also coming into the game, Lauren Nicholson, number 1 for Australia. To Talbot, and here's McBeggar. And I thought for a minute there was going to be a charge, but instead it is indeed a reach on the Philippines.
And as I was just saying, the Philippines have dropped into a 2-3 zone. They are going to try and defend that paint a little bit better than they have. We're now interested to see, do Australia change what they've done? At the moment, they've got a slightly big rotation on the floor. Still got shooters on the floor. Are they going to zip the ball around the perimeter, open up some perimeter shots now for them?
So that foul's on Tonko, who's checked in, number 14. Also in now is Rio Joy Nabilan, number 8. The Philippines. McBeggar makes 1 of 2. Hayes and the Philippines break the press. Well, they're going to have to break that press. Tonko launches it from a long way out. Now Steph Talbot gets it over to Seacamp, and she puts it up with the left hand.
And this is exactly what Coach Bondello was talking about. She said, can I get some rim-to-rim running? That's exactly what she wants to see. She wants to see the defensive rebound come down and for the ball to be pushed at pace, because they know at the moment the Philippines aren't running hard transition defense.
Hayes grazes the outside of the net, goes out of bounds, and Australia get the ball back. Skip pass. Now in it goes to Blitzav. She takes the foul, and she will go to the line. So Jose picks up the personal.
And this is part of the key again. As much as you're playing zone and you're guarding obviously an area, you have to be tracking the people cutting through your area. You need to be putting a body on them. If they're cutters, you need to give them a slight bump. If they're looking to post or receive the ball, you need to be making sure that you're physical with them.
Litzaz reaches up and almost forces a turnover. To undergo knee reconstruction after the back in 2017, after helping Australia get to the final here in this tournament. Litzaz has come back. I think it was injuries that kind of brought an end to both of her parents' careers, who were basketball players. Here's a nice drive and a basket right before the shot clock expired from Bernardino.
Yeah, it was. It was knee injuries that brought a career shortening for her parents, and you hope it's not something that's in her DNA.
Well, pass to McBeggar, now out to Steph Talbot, and she drills a three. And Australia right now are just rolling. But both of her parents play for Australia. How many basketball players can say that? I know my parents didn't play for the national team.
No, absolutely not. Absolutely not. It's a proud family of basketball enthusiasts. I can't imagine what Christmas is like for them, though.
The apple did not fall far from the tree. In either case. Good drive, good defense by Seacamp, forcing the turnover. Here's Talbot on the break and puts it up and scores with a left hand, and a reach and a foul puts her on the line. And we've got 142 remaining, and Australia have already got 34 points. This is going to be a big number on the scoreboard today for Australia.
Yeah, you have a feeling, as we see the replay of another fast break layup, that the Australians have come to prove a point. The last time they played on this floor won't bring back happy memories. They want to put those to bed early, and they also want to send a message out to every other team in this tournament that we're number one in the world for a reason. Do you know what I mean? Sorry, in the region for a reason. You know, we're silver medalists from the World Cup for a reason. This is, you know, we are here to win everything, and we're not going to make mistakes.
Well, they want to prove that 2 years ago they can do better than that they can finish things off, but there are going to be some moments where they're going to face some adversity in this tournament, the Opals. And I think they fully expect that. Here's Hayes, quick pass, and nice finish. Bernardino, and Talbot committed the foul. She kind of put her side into her. She was going up. Watch this. She just kind of ran into her in the end.
It's always a dangerous one when you're going up for a layup and someone clips below your hips. It kind of has a way of flipping you up. Completely unintentional. But again, another good play by Miranda. She's gone, you know, sorry, not Miranda, Bernardino. She's gone tough to the basket. She's gone strong and converted the three-point play.
McBeggar turns and scores. Tell you, look at McBeggar and you just think, wow, what a, you know, basketball body she's got. She's got good length, and there's no wonder that she is on the radar big time. Here's nice pull up from Kelly Hayes,
and the Philippines will need plenty of Kelly Hayes scoring, I think, in this tournament. She's one of their high profile players, one with an awful lot of potential for the future.
Nobody going for the rebound that time for the Philippines. So swooping in for the rebound, Australia, and they get another foul that time. It was Nicholson, Lauren Nicholson. Leilani Mitchell comes in.
And there's just no respite when you play Australia. You just see the rotation through all 12 players, and it's just quality after quality that's rolling off this bench. And if you're the Philippines, you just kind of think, is there not just a weak link that we can exploit? And for Australia, there isn't at the moment.
Nicholson makes that free throw as well. Goes up to 38 points now for Australia. Hayes behind the arc, now gets in. Hands it off. And missing everything was Miranda. Now Mitchell has it. And going baseline, Nicholson. Miranda has it. They're going to have to launch it. No, Mitchell sneaks in there, takes it away, and that's how it finishes. It's all Australia. It's all Opals. It's all from the team down under right now. They are cruising here against Philippines. In Bengaluru, they're up 38-16 at the end of the first quarter. Well, Mark, in this case, the stats don't lie. 10 of 17 inside the arc for Australia, and just wreaking havoc. I mean, the one stat we don't see there are the rebounds, and they're just drilling the Philippines on the boards.
Yeah, 21 rebounds after that first quarter, 10 offensive rebounds in the first 10 minutes. It's not a stat line that can continue if the Philippines want to be any form of power in this tournament as a whole, not just this game. But the concern for the Philippines for me as well is they seem to just be wanting to go inside into the paint, and that seems to be the weakness. They surely want to be creating outside shots. I do like the direct nature of the play, but they also do need to have some perimeter play as well.
So everybody getting in on the act right now for Australia. Every player is going to get considerable minutes, you would imagine. Three different players have hit shots from long range for Australia, and everybody's active on the boards.
Yeah, big performances obviously from Beck Allen so far. 9 points, three boards. Kayla George, 7 points, three boards. But like you say, you have a feeling it's going to be pretty consistent throughout their 12 players for minutes and potentially offensive production as well.
Bernardino gets in the paint, has the ball knocked away, but then taking it right back was Cabinben, and she puts it up. Nice play by France Cabinben. Bishop has checked in. She turns, puts it up. Nice finish.
That's nice because she turned and she'd read the game straight away. She'd read a defender and she knew that it was going to have to be a slight adjustment and a bit more of a scoop than she would have wanted to do. But something that you practice time and time again, and the practice pays off.
Miranda, good drive, getting some space to shoot. Jenna Hay back in, gets it to Garbin, who gets it back. Nice little give and go.
And Cabinben cannot just turn off like that. She did great first defense to make the Australia pick up their dribble, but then she just gave up and let the drive to the basket. It's just criminal. You need to stay on tune.
Hayes misses from deep, and now Talbot rebounds and runs and gets it to Mitchell, and Hayes gets the block.
That's good help defense by Kelly Hayes. A good read. She saw that her teammate needed her, and she stepped across.
Pontejos comes back into the game.
Hayes goes out. Jose goes out, and coming in is Chan for the Philippines, number 12. Garvin just grazes the outside of the net. Darcy Garvin. Bernardino, she's got the moves. She's getting good looks.
Yeah, she definitely has been impressive so far.
But then she comes down and reaches and commits the foul.
And this has been my biggest issue with the Philippines, is this transition defense. You know, I don't know if it's just not the system that's not in there that they need to chase back, but they seem to be not working hard enough to get back and play defense quick enough.
Okay, short little baseline jumper. Dribbling the ball around up high, cabin bin, and then end up turning it over to Bishop. Good two-handed overhead pass. Now Garvin, well, she left her feet. Was able to actually get a decent shot. Rebounds to miss, now back to Talbot. And this time the blue shirts come up with the basketball.
And that's much better. You're seeing three Filipino players actually fighting and trying to box out and hustling for that rebound.
Three. Montejos goes back for the ball, but she was boxed out over there by Bishop. So Beck Allen and Ebzuri will come back in. Garvin and Talbot now go take a seat. Well, a lot to like about Australia, but you know, it's obviously not a test, any type of test for them. They've come out and really just kind of shown their class here early against the Philippines. Jenoa Hay tries to get it to Bishop. Ball goes out of bounds. She looks at the ref as if to say, Chan was holding me.
It's games like this for Australia, though, that it's where coaching almost comes into its own, because you don't want to become complacent. This is the start of a long tournament, you know, a very intense tournament, and they need to make sure that they keep good habits, even in games like this where they've taken out big leads.
Pulled up shooting was Hayes. She's off target. Now O'Hay. Becky Allen. And a little bump. Play Pontejos, and Australia just getting pretty much, you know, what they want right now. So you look at this Australia team, and they've got they represent some of the clubs from the WNBL. Melbourne has a couple of players, and George and McBeggar. I'm sure the fans down of the Southside Flyers are interested in this game. They've got a few players with Jenna O'Hay, Leilani Mitchell, Litzabs as well. Ball goes out of bounds. It used to be called Danidong. Did you know that?
No. Every day's a school day with you, Jeff, that's for sure.
Well, class is now, we're going to have a break. And we're going to go down to the bench as a timeout has been called. Since we haven't gone to the bench yet. Okay, here we go.
Okay, the first time they get two easy baskets. I'm trying here, down here, make it harder for them. Okay, don't be afraid to switch it. Okay, so come on, listen a little
here
bit.
Here we go, we've got it.
Now, on the
well, I'm not sure if you can hear that, folks, so I'll go ahead and say.
Here on the middle, okay, but otherwise, we just get screened and we're going to get wide open looks so we can penetrate
straight away, you mean?
Yeah, you know when we're dribbling down here.
Wait, just scary, you can do this. If you're on the wing, you can do this. Oh, come on.
That stat there does not make for pretty viewing for the Philippines.
That's a tough one. That's a tough one to look at. The thing that I like, though, is you look in their huddle, and they've got perspective. You know, they knew coming into this game against Australia, it was always going to be a big ask. It was probably the toughest game that they'll face potentially here in Bangalore, and they've not become fazed by it. They know that beating Australia isn't probably their number one priority. It's some of the other teams around them that they want to, you know, pick up the wins against, the likes of Chinese Taipei or Korea. Those are the games where maybe they can push that upset. The game against Australia, winning or losing isn't make or break for their tournament, and it's good to have that perspective as a player.
So Leilani Mitchell gets it over to Becky Allen. And an easy one for Abby Bishop. So coming right at the timeout, Australia get another two. Oh, a little bit of contact there. Ebzeri and Chan, that was a lot of flesh on flesh, but I think they both ended up okay. Might be a little sore after that one. Leilani Mitchell will bring it up the floor. Mitchell. Now Jenna O'Hay. Back into the corner to O'Hay, and O'Hay, hey, drills the three.
I'm loving what Australia are doing at the moment. The patience on the offensive end is wonderful. When you're in a situation like this, the kind of motivation to go quickly and try and score quickly can get a bit too much, but they're so patient, making sure that it's the right shot that they're taking.
Chan misses again. Now Mitchell passes up to O'Hay. She's fouled by Hayes.
Yeah, Hayes fell asleep on that one. You can't run transition defense without having half an eye on where the ball's coming from.
Well, just a little bit of a contact there, a little bit of a nudge perhaps. That was O'Hay drilling it from the right.
So what is your favorite women's basketball team down under, and in terms of the mascot?
Oh, I don't know with regards to the mascot. I kind of have a soft spot, and I'm probably going to get in trouble now on social media for Townsville Fire. I don't know why. I've been to Townsville,
because
and I really enjoyed myself.
Because it's a team of winners. How about that?
Yeah, that's probably it.
And it's not far from Magnetic Island.
No, it's not. Exactly. Very good knowledge. Yeah, the ferry across the Magnetic Island.
Absolutely. Great place to go. Great part of the world. Here's the three-pointer, or actually it's inside the arc. I have to say mine probably is the boomer. Mitchell gets it in, and the ball goes out of bounds. Now, it's going to be Philippines possession. I know that you're a boomer, right? You're a baby boomer.
Yeah, kind of, just about.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're not a millennial.
No, I'm 3 months short of being a millennial. If I was 3 months younger, I'd technically be a millennial. I wouldn't be in my real life, but yeah.
They're not the baby boomers, the Melbourne boomers, although that might be a good name for a youth team. But do you know what the boomer is?
I presume it's some form of animal.
Yep, another name for a kangaroo.
Ah, there you go.
Nice drive, and shot is good from Bernardino. State of supply points from her today.
And this is going to be important for the Philippines as well. They need to see which players are going to want to step up, because they'll start focusing their future game offense around these players. And the likes of Bernardino is showing that she can really play on the offensive end.
Well, this quickly is the Philippines to the other end. And Miranda puts it up and is fouled. And we'll go to the line. Kayla George raised her hands, looks away in disgust. Look at this. Well, she probably would have got away with that, but I think she had that swiping motion.
Yeah, it's the movement of the arm. If the arm had stayed straight up, she'd have been all right. It's just when she brings it down.
And there was definitely contact there with the left elbow of Miranda and the arm. And Miranda did not convert the three-point play. Chance. McAllen to George. Seacamp. Look at Australia. Pass it around over to Blitzives. Seacamp rebounds it, tries to get it to Blitzives.
And back to Blitz Ives in the paint. 3 seconds. I thought that she might get called for that because she was on her backside in the paint.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
She didn't get out.
Yeah, no, she didn't reestablish herself outside the paint once she'd fallen over. So it's a pretty easy call for the officials. Weirdly, Philippines are really running an undersized lineup now. And this is the best that they've defended the paint. Because all the Australian bigs are putting the ball on the floor. They're taking a drop step bounce or something along those lines. And the Filipinos are able to put their hands into it.
And the three-pointer is good for Miranda. Here comes the Philippines. A little bit more feisty approach from the smaller lineup. Miranda was banging down low with Kayla George.
And I don't mind that as a foul. They've taken this kind of defensive scrappiness up a few gears. As you see, oh, wonderful step back. James Harden-esque step back.
That was good. So Ebsery goes out of the game for Australia. And Steph Talbot comes back in. And good little spell of play here by the Philippines. But Kayla George goes to the line. Shoots it exceptionally well, really, for, you know, you remember, you look at Kayla George and you're like, okay, low post threat, which she is, but she can step outside. She's got a nice stroke.
She's played a trade, you know, across several European countries as well, so she's a very experienced player. And
WNBA as well.
Yeah, it's an impressive kind of resume that she's got, and the Australians will lean heavily this week on her.
Three-point attempt. Another one is good from Miranda. Reading the rights, Miranda. 53-29.
Wasn't what we were expecting. She only shot 20% from outside in the last Asia Cup. So an unbelievable shooting performance today so far from Miranda.
McAllen, that was a two. It was a long two.
It feels like someone's lit the touch paper to this game. We kind of had a slow phase, and now both teams have really stepped it up again as we kind of close out this second quarter.
2:20 remaining in the first half. And now another three, and it's good from Castillo.
And this is exactly what I was talking about. I said the Philippines need to look outside.
And there was no stop there, but Talbot missed the layup. And she gets the ball back and puts it up and in. Australia will get away with that against the Philippines.
But these are mistakes that Coach Bondello will not be happy seeing.
Well, Castillo says, I can do it again. Nope, this time she was a little bit short, but quite frankly, that modus operandi might be the way forward for them. Talbot off the back of the iron, and again, the rebounds there. Kayla George missed a couple of easy ones.
Wise move now by Diaz. It's time to slow it down a little bit, take the pace out of the game. Philippines have got a little bit of a run.
Bernardino tried to go baseline, and Beck Allen just took it away. Now she gets it to George. Kayla George to Seacamp, over to Talbot. Oh, look at that. Just Philippines lost defensively on some of these trips down the floor by Australia. They've been hustling, but they're just a little bit lost. Wide open Opals. This was Beck Allen reaching in, knocking it away from Bernardino. And this was, well, where's the D?
Yeah, and this is the thing. You've got Bernardino. She's still lying on the floor at the other end, kind of a bit annoyed that she hasn't had a foul called. And then you've got Jose, who's playing, you know, straight up defense, match up man-to-man defense. And it's not working. You need to help out at this point.
Miranda's 15 leads the way in terms of scoring. Bernardino now has 8.
Open shot every single time. You can run horns for IK, but it's a point zone here. Next time we run here, right now, okay? Run horns, run, but when you pass it, as he came to drive, go this way. Now, you pass it as you can cut, Kayla, you may come in the middle, you will be open. Okay, if not, we just, you know, pass it corner, dribble out, and play out of it.
Here you
go. Execute, 1, 2, 3. Execute. Finish strong now. No, can't score it. Here
we go. Look at Miranda. 15 points, 3 rebounds, all in a day's work. But
Looks like she has expended quite a bit in this little run. And she's going to take a seat here, possibly for the remainder of the first half.
Yeah, I think it's a smart coaching move. Give her that extra couple of minutes of game time, sitting down, you know, get her breath back and get her ready to start the second half. And hopefully she can keep the same shooting form.
Kelly Hayes puts it on the deck. And a foul called on Australia. So two free throws coming for Hayes.
And I like that, trying to use Hayes' foot speed against McBeggar, and it's asking McBeggar to do something that's maybe slightly out of her kind of game set at the moment. Picking someone up on the perimeter and having to guard them as they drive to the basket and shepherding them away from the hoop is maybe an area that she needs to work on in her game.
So Hayes makes the first and the second, and Philippines try to keep that scoreline respectable before halftime. Seacamp, or not to get it any further out of hand, probably is the best way to put it. Nicholson now from the left, ball rattled out. Seacamp there for the offensive rebound and putback. Seen a lot of that today.
And I liked what Days did in that instance. She strayed away. She's massively undersized, but she chose McBeggar, and she literally locked her out on the box out. If all five Filipino players can do that, they're actually going to lock down their boards an awful lot more than they are at the moment.
George takes it away. Now Talbot, 3-on-2. McBeggar, beautiful pass. And Seacamp missed the layup, but McBeggar with the rebound. George passes up to three, follows up her miss, and misses again. So Australia will have to settle for 61 points at the break. So as the players go to the benches and then retreat to the changing rooms, Australia have a 61-34 lead at halftime.
Australia 61, Philippines 34.
Well, they have been convincing as expected, Australia, but at least from the Philippines, you can see their spirits were lifted somewhat midway through that second quarter when they started making some shots from deep.
Yeah, their shot percentages have gone through the roof from the start of the game. They were 1 from 5 to start the game. They've hit another 2 from 6 at least in that kind of second phase. And that's a highlight for the Philippines to be able to do that.
This is the stat here that basically tells the story.
Yeah, 41-8. I'm not sure I've ever seen a rebound battle so one-sided, and almost as many offensive rebounds as defensive rebounds for Australia.
So the rest of the stats as well. So really, Australia, they've come here, you know, their second attempt at winning a FIBA Women's Asia Cup title. The men were able to do it in Lebanon a couple of years ago. Now the women are hoping that they can reach the top of the podium, and they no doubt will, you know, expect to face real opposition from three-time defending champions Japan, China, and especially that couple of teams, Korea, perhaps. We're not exactly sure what Korea is going to have in this tournament. New Zealand, of course. I think we might be pleasantly surprised by what the Tall Ferns have brought, and also Chinese Taipei always can be very awkward. So there will be tougher games for Australia in this event, and they probably know it. And what do you think? Do you think it's good to start off with a game like this?
Yeah, it's kind of a double-edged sword. You want a nice, easy game to get yourself into the flow of things. You don't want to have to play your toughest competitor, say maybe Japan, on that opening day. But you also don't want to become complacent in your own mind, you know. And I think you saw that a little bit in the Philippines run. You saw maybe the Australians taking a little bit of foot off the gas, and, you know, defensively their brains not being completely switched on to maybe what the Philippines can do from the outside. And I think for Sandy Brondello, that's, you know, Coach Brondello is going to be very happy that they've had a little bit of a run against them. So it's woken her team up. And for the Australians, yes, they have a comfortable lead. They've looked comfortable and they've dominated the paint, but they haven't been perfect. And that's something they need to work towards.
Well, 17 fast break points for Australia, 21 second chance points, 34 points in the paint, 24 points from the bench for Australia. I mean, they're, you know, overall, they're turning on all cylinders. And you know, thankfully for the Philippines, they were able to get a burst of points there. And you can see, again, it really did lift their spirits, even though they were down considerably during one of their timeouts. On the scoreboard, there were a few smiles after Miranda poured in, drilled, was it three? She's got three three-pointers and went to 15 points.
The point for me with the Philippines in the second half, if they want to make this more of a contest and battle back into it, one, they've got to lock down the defensive rebounds. How they do that, I think they have to follow the model that Dave showed at the back end. Everyone just grab a player and box out as strong as you can. It doesn't matter if you're giving up 30, 40 centimeters. It's completely irrelevant. Just box out. If we can do that, we've got a chance of actually trying to equalize this rebounding battle. And then on the other side, I think the transition defense is absolutely critical to what they do.
Well, this is the first game of four today. Korea, Chinese Taipei will follow. Then the third game of the day will be China, New Zealand. And we'll wrap things up with the three-time defending champions, Japan against India. We're at halftime, Australia on top, 61-34 over the Philippines. We will be right back.
Well, Gemma Miranda, thanks to her 15 points, Philippines have at least been able to keep that scoreboard ticking over. They trail 61-34 to a rampant Australia here in Bengaluru. And I don't want to say there's no way back for the Philippines, but they're going to have substantial improvement in all areas, especially on the boards. They got to take care of things on the defensive boards. Australia just absolutely drilled them in that department.
Yeah, 41 rebounds for Australia in that first half, 20 offensive rebounds. The likes of Kayla George, she's up to 8 boards, 4 offensive rebounds to her name alone. And that's what you're going to need to do if you're the Philippines now. Whether it's about winning this game or whether it's about setting yourself up for the rest of the tournament, they need to do better on the boards in this second half. Because ultimately, every other team they're playing against is now scouting this game and saying, OK, where are the weaknesses? Where can we pick them apart? And at the moment, that's where you can pick them apart. For Australia, it's difficult. You want to keep pushing. They're going to keep pushing. It's a great opportunity for them to try some different things, different rotations, maybe go a little bit smaller, go a little bit bigger, running maybe some different press zones and things like that. A real opportunity for Coach Bondello to explore what her team are capable of doing.
Of Sandy Brondello. Final words to her team before the second half. You look back at a couple years ago, you see Jenna O'Hay, she wasn't in that team a couple years ago, but she's got 13 points, 4 rebounds today. The players that were here and that are here again, I take it back, she was here, Jenna O'Hay. Aaron Phillips, we'll give you that in a second here. Here's Animan, who had the foul trouble, and she had to leave early, didn't she?
Yeah, she picked up 3 fouls in the first quarter, and I was amazed they left her on the court when she picked up that second one, to be honest with you. But interesting to see if she's able to control that foul situation now. There's going to be an awful lot of pressure put on her by McBeggar.
Pontejos has got the ability to get hot, much like Miranda. But she hasn't gotten on track today. Here she is. She had a memorable tournament a couple of years ago. Cabin bend, beautiful bounce pass, but the swat from Izzy. Now Miranda and Talbot with the rebound. Mitchell, open floor. McBeggar flies in, and there is a foul. So sorry, going back, the players that were here, O'Hay was not here, but Ebzeri was here. Of course, Belinda Snell, who's now retired, is an assistant coach in the WNBL. And McBeggar goes up, powers her way up and scores.
Yeah, and on that last play, the big concern for the Philippines is that's the fourth foul on Pontejos.
Good reach, Talbot knocking it away. So Bernardino commits the foul. But sorry, Blitzevs, obviously she was here before she had the serious knee injury. Boy, she really was put through the ringer with her injuries. Here's Talbot. Of course, these players know that these Australians, they will fully expect to be at the Olympics next year. And they'll have to qualify for those. Here's Mitchell, and drills a three. So they know that good performances are needed here in India to make sure that they're on the plane to Tokyo.
And the expectation is they are going to be on that plane to Tokyo, but you don't want to be, falling for that banana skin and slipping up in a tournament like this. It only takes one bad result to change the psychology of your team and potentially put you on the down run.
Foul on Ebzeri. You know, what happened 2 years ago? They actually beat Japan earlier in the tournament, but then they lost in the final. So it wasn't like they weren't able to beat the Japanese, but the Japanese won when it really mattered. Pontejos goes behind her back. Shot clock winding down, goes off 1 foot. McBeggar with the rebound.
Mitchell up ahead and putting it up and in was Australia's number 11, Darcy Garbin.
Absolutely love how Mitchell's playing the game. Heads up point guard is exactly what every coach wants. She doesn't look down for 1 second. She's looking for her teammates every time she's got the ball.
Another swat, second swat of this half by McBeggar. And here she is running the break well, catches it, scores.
And again, Mitchell doing a great job rewarding your bigs. When they're going to run the floor, you've got to make sure you give them the ball, because otherwise they'll give up running eventually. But a wonderful find and an easy basket for McBeggar.
Cabin Ben hands it off to Miranda. Two shots coming for the impressive Filipino.
Miranda has been quite impressive in today's game so far, and only 24 years old, so you imagine that she could be one of the mainstays and the big names of women's Filipino basketball for quite a few years to come, and you'll see her in quite a few Asia Cup tournaments.
Good defense from Animan, taking that pass away. Bernardino passes up the three attempt and misses on the drive. Now Edzeri, oh, catches the shoulder. Well, Edzeri asking, did she even play the ball? Did she go for the ball? And I think she's right. She kind of, Miranda kind of lowered her shoulder. And not for the first time today, Edzeri has been smacked by the Philippines.
And I won't think it'll be the last time this week that the Australians get roughed up. You have a feeling that might be a tactic a few teams employ against them.
Boy, McBeggar had Edzeri wide open. And now the pass to Edzeri goes off her hands. She was wide open on her cut to the basket. And McBeggar didn't see her.
And Australia are dealing with this zone defense that the Philippines are throwing at them pretty well. They're moving the ball really quickly, and that's the key. The ball's got to move as quick as you possibly can.
So the 22 assists for Australia. Here's McBeggar. Again, another pass down low. Edzeri this time decides to bring it back out. She gives the bounce pass to Mitchell, who goes up. And Bernardino goes up. Plenty of contact, but no foul. So Mitchell is going to go out of the game, as is Talbot. O'Hay's coming back in. And Beck Allen. Here's McBeggar. Turns and scores.
And again, the Australians show so much patience on the offensive end. They're willing to wait to those last few seconds because they know if they're patient enough that they will get that open shot.
Three-point attempt. And, oh, and Edzeri, I think, is going to be called for a foul. A little bit of frustration, I think, creeping into the game of Edzeri here after she didn't get a call. Watch this. Just kind of raised her left arm. And that was McBeggar at the other end.
Frustration from Edzeri. You can understand it. You know, she thought she should have had a call at the other end, but she's experienced enough and mature enough to know that it's not going to get her anywhere with the officials.
Cabin doing bounce pass. Ooh, Animan passed it up. Fontejos goes in, swatted by Beck Allen. And McBeggar, oh, a little bit out of control, but maybe it could have been that Animan was in the circle there. Now at the other end, Miranda had her shot affected or blocked by McBeggar. And now McBeggar slow coming back down to the other end. She might be coming out here in a second. Here's Becky Allen, puts it up.
I think that's her first miss from the field today, so the Filipinos will be hoping it won't be the last miss for her as well.
Montejo has her shot blocked by Ebsery. Now Ebsery looks up to O'Hay, and it's a layup drill for Australia.
And this is what we were talking about, the Filipino team aren't running transition defense hard enough. I don't know if it's a fitness issue. We're going to see three changes now, so maybe that is what the problem is for the Filipinos, to be able to run back hard enough and quick enough to keep up with the Australians.
And now the reach and the foul. I mean, I got to tell you, Mark, it's you know, we experienced a little bit of jet lag after our long trip, and you know these players as well. Clear foul on McBeggar. You know, the players, I was thinking, New Zealand didn't come around for their shoot around yesterday, and I think that they were one of the later teams to arrive. I can understand why. You need to rest up.
Yeah, it's a balance, isn't it, between fine-tuning and getting the on-court stuff right, and to be actually rested and in the time zone, as it were, making sure that you're ready to play at the specific time you're going to play as well.
Well, Abby Bishop sneaks in there and takes the ball away. Hands it off to Seacamp. Seacamp passes down, and Brondello's emphasis on the passing game is showing here, but the ball turned over. This time it was by Tonko. George brings it up, hands it off to Allen. Now George gets it down low. Gets it back, passes it back outside to Allen. And Seacamp. The Philippines struggling to get the ball back now. Bishop. Right idea. And Sandy Brondell is like, oh, come on, we got to do a little bit better there, a little bit better execution.
And the thing is the Filipinos that are actually impacting on the defensive end, they have kind of cranked up the scrappiness in their defense. They're getting in passing lanes, and you can see it. You saw then Beck Allen pushing one of the Filipino players when she boxed her out, and there's frustration now with the Australians. They're not getting it all their own way on that end.
Tonko. Well, it'll be very interesting to see which of these opals, as Aquino looks on from the Philippines, which ones are on the plane to Tokyo.
And that's a big part, as individual players. This is their shot.
Oh, boy, Kayla George clearing out down low on Chan and called for an unsportsmanlike foul.
And this is what I was talking about before. This scrappiness from the Philippines is starting to annoy the Australian players. They're not getting it all their own way. They're not getting all the calls they think they should get. What they need to do is let the officials referee the game.
Yeah, there was definitely a little bit too much there from George. So unsportsmanlike foul puts Chan on the line, and I know that she got under the skin in the first half of the Australian players when she came in.
The issue you've got as well is if you're George, you're probably not used to maybe posting up against someone who has such an undersize against you. So when you're turning, you're swinging your arms thinking you're going to, you know, catch someone's shoulder or something like that, or hip. You're actually catching it full in the face.
Hayes misses everything. 2:34 to go here in the third quarter.
Yeah, Hayes hasn't had the start to her Asia Cup. She'll have wanted only 4 points to her name.
Quick pass to O'Hay, but she misses. Good D by Beck Allen, forcing another turnover. Now she's got it. She hands it off to O'Hay, and Hayes goes up, and I'll tell you what. That's flirting with an unsportsmanlike.
Yeah, both teams need to be a little bit careful now. It's getting a little bit too physical and unnecessary.
And Hayes did the right thing to go check on O'Hay. Watch this. This is, I would have guessed if they went to look at that, they might call it an unsportsmanlike.
It's difficult, isn't it?
Dangerous.
The easy call is when you're not going for the ball at all. That makes it so easy, officials. But obviously Hayes has gone for the ball there, but it's maybe a little bit too eager and a little bit too much aggression. And it's probably more frustration out of her own game than the Australians. It's not gone her way. She's wanted to come out and maybe kind of stake a claim to be one of the big names, one of the big players for the Philippines, and it's not quite rolled that way for her today.
Well, hey, having a nice little first game here for the Opals. I like it when a player like O'Hay gets up after she's been completely decked by the other team and just doesn't say anything. Here's the ball turned back over. Here's O'Hay. Beautiful pass to Bishop.
And all off the back of a 2-2-1 zone press. Absolutely love this press. If anyone that knows me, I get my geek on for zone presses. Well broken by the Philippines, though.
Well, I knew you. I didn't know that you really liked the 2-2-1. You've kept that a secret from me, but now the secret is out.
Any combination of zone press is good for me.
Three-pointer's good from Tomko. George, short, Bishop gets the rebound, puts it up and in, and she was also fouled, an unsportsmanlike, called on Tomko for kicking as she went for the putback. I mean, Bishop did a great job. She had Tomko right at her feet so she couldn't move. She caught the ball and was able to put it back up and in, and then while she was scoring, Tomko stuck her leg out. Look at this. But looking at it from that angle, it looked almost like it was inadvertent. It was like it wasn't intentional. This is Tomko, meanwhile, hitting the three.
Yeah, from that replay, we didn't get a great view of it, but it did almost look like gravity was just bringing her legs back down again. She wasn't willing to continue doing that ab crunch while she waited for the Australians to score.
That said, you know what? They might have gotten away with one before that. So
yeah, I think so.
Bernardino getting up on Seacamp. I mean, you know what? I don't have a problem with that defense from Bernardino. I mean, the only thing is you're getting beat by 43 points. And Australia might be thinking, where is all this aggression coming from? But at the end of the day, you got to get after it.
The thing is, in a game like this, when you're all the Philippines, you don't. The scoreboard's irrelevant now.
Yeah.
It's possession by possession. You have that personal pride as an athlete that, you know.
And you got to start trying to play better for the rest of this tournament.
Absolutely. You need to start the engine. You need to get that spark going to start the engine for the whole tournament. This is an intense tournament where games just keep coming at these players, and they need to make sure they're ready for it.
Now, Blitzhouse is going to come back in, and your favorite 2-2-1 was going to be employed yet again, but we've got a timeout. Perhaps wisely called by Aquino. And Aquino is questioning the unsportsmanlike. I think, anyway, out of your screen, just out of your screen, he's talking to the referee. And the Philippines are going to regather. That's the scoring by points. You can see Australia have really turned it up a notch here in the third quarter. 23-6, they've outscored the Philippines. Well, that's been the big problem all game, hasn't it? The rebounding.
And that's the key, you know, they use that as their chant leaving the huddle, the Australians, as we see the stats for McBeg, 11 points, 4 rebounds. It's a good game for her. But that's the key for them, and it's going to be the key for the whole tournament is execute. They've got their game plans. They've obviously got several different looks on the defensive end, several different looks on the offensive end, and it's just making sure they execute to that game plan.
Hustling back, and the ball knocked away from Jose. Here comes Australia. The Philippines coming out of the timeout, turn it over yet again against the pressure. Jose gets it to Bishop again. Great job holding onto the ball with a lot of contact there. Watch this. Jose gets it. And, well, Tonko was able to get a lot of ball there, but I think was... may have gotten a little bit of Bishop. No, they're not going to say. They're going to say it is Filipino basketball.
Yeah, calling the travel.
Well, that's why Tonko had that look of why me. Nabilan.
No problem with the Filipinos looking for the outside shot. They can't be that far away from the basket. They need to get a little bit closer.
Quick pass down low, finished by Seacamp.
Wonderful vision by Bishop there, though. Just a real heads-up play, unselfish, and yeah.
And I think Sandy Brondello would have applauded that one if she could. She was just sitting back, taking it all in. Here's Tonko. $1 million move, but a 5-cent finish from her. And good defense by Bernardino taking that ball away. And right at the end of the shot clock, fouled. Did they call the foul? Oh, no, they did not. So at the end of three quarters, Australia just in complete command. 86-40 over the Philippines here on the opening day in the opening game of the FIBA Women's Asia Cup. Numbers, again, obviously it's one-sided, one-way traffic.
Yeah, they're painting the picture, and it's just down to the Australians, just their size advantage and how they're using it to its fullest, as you see McGregor just go around the corner and find the easy score. And they saw that all through the third quarter, outscoring the Philippines 25-6 in that third quarter. And Australia have so many offensive threats. They now have 11 of their 12 players on the scoreboard. They've troubled the box score. It's only Esbury that's left to trouble the scoreboard, and it's hard to see where the weak link in Australia is at the moment. And for the Philippines, I like what they've done. They've come out, they've been scrappy, maybe a little bit over aggressive at times, but at least they've not just laid down and kind of been steamrolled. They've been putting some fight in, and you know, as we spoke before, I think that's going to be critical that they have that spark in this final 10 minutes to really try and set the tone for their tournament.
So Nicholson, Mitchell, Blitzavs, Bishop, and Garbin. Darcy Garbin in the game right now.
For the clock to be reset to 10, if you're wondering what we're waiting for here in the arena.
I think that's what Kayla was wondering over there on the bench. What are they waiting for? Okay, now we're underway. So Mitchell, oh, bounce pass. Right idea from Garvin, but threw it right at the feet of Bishop, and the ball goes out of bounds.
Yeah, way too close for a bounce pass. If anything, she just wanted a little shot fake, get a player to come towards her and then be able to pass the ball around the corner.
And Bernardino throws the ball, and it's a little bit too high for Castillo.
Interesting, Australia dropping into a 2-3 zone as well, so we're going to have a bit of a zone off, it looks like, in this final 10 minutes. But interesting one for Australia as well, because that really does give up the outside shot and limit the interior options, which really isn't a problem for them against the Philippines.
Blitzavs, ball goes through her hands, but she gets it back. Blitzavs pulls up at the line, and good rebound from Garbin, hands it off. And scoring was Lauren Nicholson. And a little trip there by Abby Bishop.
And that'll definitely be one of the high points they take out of this game. The performance of Miranda has been, you know, one of the real standouts for the Philippines. She's had a really, really strong game, 17 points. And a smart play, you know, the patience to wait for the defender to overcommit and then go past.
You see, that was definitely a foul. Bishop stuck her right leg out. There's Bernardino, brings a little bit of rain. Well, take your pick, Bernardino or Miranda.
I think it's a great 1-2 punch for the Philippines, and one that I think we'll be seeing all week for them.
And now Garbin collides with Bernardino. It'll be Australia inbounding it. Is Garbin, oh, sweet stroke from the charity stripe.
That's a nice range to have if you're a bigger player. To be able to have that kind of elbow jumper is a real kind of weapon that you can use and stretch the defenders.
Miranda with the bounce pass, oh, beautiful finish. Talk about those two players, they worked well that time. Now the pass to Garbin, gets it right back for Australia.
Philippines going forward, if they can get that 1-2 punch in the backcourt walking and the likes of Anaman and maybe Kelly Hayes starting to pick up a little bit more of the weight in the front court, they could potentially be quite a threat.
Castillo. Now Mitchell. And Blitzavs tries to go baseline. It'll be Australia inbounding it. That was the bounce pass that Bernardino finished for the Philippines. They've had their moments today.
Yeah, they've certainly shown glimmers of what they can do. It's just the consistency and prolonging those kind of glimmers into long phases of good play.
Oh, Blitzavs launching it, and Miranda might have gotten away with a push. She ends up tying up Garbin. And you have to, you know, the odd, shall we say, rough play from Miranda. You got to come and bring it against a team like Australia, though.
Yeah, it's part of the difference that you're going to make. If you're a team like the Philippines, if they'd come out kind of with this scrappy intensity at the start of the game, I think we might have been in a closer game than we are now.
That time they turned it over against the 2-3 zone. Bishop just reached around and knocked it away. Nicholson misses it from deep. And going to the free throw line will be the Opals. Miranda also has 4 fouls. I tell you, you realize the pipeline of talent that Australia have when you go. I went to Bangkok to watch them in the Under-19 World Cup this summer. Did you happen to catch any of that?
I saw some of it, bits and bits.
That was their tournament to win. I mean, USA eked out a victory in the title game. And there's a lot of good young players coming up for Australia.
The Australian system is one of those that I think could be replicated. You could look at it be potentially being put in place in other places around the world, because the use of the word pipeline is exactly right. It's just a conveyor belt of talent that is inspired by the generation that have gone before them to achieve. And it's great to see that. You see in the men's team, the coaching staff have been there, done that. Luke Longley, for example, you can't get a bigger name in Australian basketball. And the same in the women's team with Coach Bondello.
Good drive from Bernardino, and she is fouled as well. Well, we can't say enough positives about Bernardino, certainly offensively. Look at this. She is fearless.
Yeah, Bernardino and Miranda are going to be critical for the Philippines if they're going to come away with a successful tournament for them. Obviously, they only just avoided relegation to Division B last year, so...
2 years ago.
North Korea. Yeah. So you imagine their target is potentially, can they get in a top four?
Well, the pass to Garvin. Now Nicholson, and hits the three. How about that? There's another Lauren shooting three-pointers. Able to throw the ball off of Bishop.
And my issue I have at the moment, the Australians are running a 2-3 zone and slightly switching out to a 3-2 zone when the shooting options come open. What they need to do if you're Philippines is overload. Don't have a balanced offense. It's the last thing you want to run against a balanced zone defense. Overload onto one side.
But this time, Anemum had a chance down low but missed. It's been that kind of day for Pontejos. Hasn't gotten anything going offensively, and now it looks like she's jammed her finger.
Yeah, 0 from 9 from the field is not a stat line we expected to see from Pontejos before the game.
From the captain. So Miranda's going to come back in for Anemum. Garvin. Edzuri back in. Letanz hits the long jumper. There's Pontejos. And able to get the ball to her teammate. Miranda puts up a short one. And Lauren Nicholson. Nicholson pulls up.
One of the great things for Australia in this game is that everyone has had possession of the ball. They've had shots. They've had, they've been part of the offense. They've been part of the defense. And that's great to be able to have 12 players see good minutes in their opening game.
Well, this time Blitzavs blocked Hayes, but Hayes got it back and scored.
Expect to see more from Kelly Hayes in the coming games. You just have a feeling that she's just finding her feet in this national team at the moment.
Nicholson. Well, her second three-pointer. She's got 10 points.
Yeah, and just over 10 minutes of play as well.
And Pontejos just can't buy a basket right now. Nicholson again. She's feeling it. Nope. This time, going behind her back, cabin bin. Bernardino passes up the jumper, then I think she made the reverse layup a little harder than it needed to be.
Yeah, there was a little bit too much show on the reverse layup. A nice simple one would have done the job, I think, in that situation.
Well, Sandy Brondello just 4 minutes and 13 seconds away from savoring a first win.
I guess you'd say she would savor this, or she would enjoy it.
I think it's job done. I think it's literally a tick in the box for Australia. You know, their aim is pretty much winning every game and
just
coming away with gold.
Get it out of the way.
Yeah.
Now McBeggar back in the game, yeah. Hayes.
McBeggar drives in. Oh, that's a good strong finish.
Yeah, wonderful agility to be able to change direction, make the spin move, and keep control when you've had that amount of contact.
Boy, the sky's the limit for McBeggar. As long as she puts in the work, she could be a special player. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah, I imagine the New Zealanders aren't too happy. She's born in Wellington in New Zealand, so choosing Australia over them, I'm sure that's not gone down too well. But...
well, we'll get a chance to see New Zealand later today. Here's Castillo launching it from downtown. Blitzovs grabs another rebound. And McBeggar finishes. But you have to say Kayla George today gets the award for the double-double for Australia with those 14 rebounds to go with her 11 points.
Yeah, she had an impressive start to the game, and they've obviously rested her in the second half. You imagine she's going to play quite a few minutes in the big games in this tournament, so good for her to be able to get a rest on game day one.
I'm surprised, actually, there's not another Australian player that has more than five rebounds.
No, but every Australian player has at least three.
Yeah.
So they've shared the spoils in the paint.
McBeggar, meanwhile, is close to overtaking Jenna O'Hay as... In fact, she has with that basket. She's now got a team-high 18 points. Castillo drills it from deep. So McBeggar has, in just 13 minutes and 35 seconds, 18 points.
And with that score, with Ebsery hitting the long jumper, that's every single Australian player registering now. And it's absolute kind of textbook playbook for Coach Brondello, and the Australians will be happy with how the game's gone today for them.
Yeah, Edzer hasn't really put up many shots today. It's only her third shot attempt. It's not just about the scoring. Here's the air ball from Jose.
And that's the thing, you look at the box score. If anyone's at home able to access the box score, normally you'll see quite a few zeros on a box score. The Australian box score is absolutely splattered with numbers across every player. There's very few zeros, and it just shows what a team effort they've had today. And all categories, every single player has put their shift in.
Now Hayes, almost seeking out the contact there, gets it from Blitzovs. Yeah, the only thing that McBeggar is missing is an assist today. She's got 18 points, 5 rebounds, 3 blocks. Good no-look pass. And Animam looked like she wasn't ready. Nicholson, beautiful touch pass to Talbot.
And that's the frustration if the Philippines have had quite a few occasions like that where they've done everything right. They've dragged the defense and distorted the defense, got the open look, but that final catch isn't quite there, or the shot's off place.
Now Hayes, that's what we've been waiting for. So Kelly Hayes.
Yeah, she's up to 9 points now. That will be important for the Philippines that she starts getting some confidence.
Blitzovs, meanwhile, drives in and picks up another foul from Animam. So that is a big 116 points on the board.
And for me, it is the defensive end for the Philippines that they're going to need to work on, both transition and both in the half court as well. you know, transition. They've been too slow getting back, and in the half court, there's been some confusion of when they're switching, when they're helping, how they're helping. Is it across? Is it down? And they'll need to work on that, because every team will try and exploit that.
Castillo, another one from deep, and McBeggar grabs the board. Look at her rebound and run. Now the quick pass. Great job, Blitzoff, sealing it off down low.
Really left Dazzle out there with no option but to foul her. It's either that or give away the two easy points. And the right move, really, from Daz. It's important to make sure you still at this stage make every team earn their points against you.
The final 30 seconds of this opening game ticking off the clock. McBeggar comes up, gets another positive defensive stat, and now she's got the assist. Look at that. Right on cue. Ezzy.
It's almost like she heard you. She was like, there's no way I'm leaving a column unchecked.
She's got a nice stat line, that's for sure. Plus 26 efficiency. That's a game high. And the three-point attempt no good. And now Steph Talbot maybe will hold up. Nope, they're going to go for more. Blitzives hands it off to Talbot. Beautiful run, and the foul called on Hayes. Well, I guess why not? Go for the execute the play.
In a game like this where it was obviously decided quite a long time ago, I'd still play to the buzzer. If I'm both coaches, I'm like, no, play to the buzzer. It's fine. Let's treat it as if it's a close game, because ultimately both these teams are going to be in close games, and it's important that they have this mindset and they deal with that kind of pressure situation of the clock running down and what do they want to achieve. And I like the Hayes that fouled, you know, Talbot on the way to the basket. It shows that she's determined and she's got that pride all the way to the final buzzer.
Well, Australia have rolled, I think, predictably to a big win. And maybe the best way to put it is they've warmed up for the tournament with this one. Philippines, you know, some good things perhaps they can build on. It was a blowout. They hit the rim with that last attempt there from Nabilan, but it's Australia that reigns supreme in the opening game of the FIBA Women's Asia Cup, 123-57. For the Philippines.
And it, like you said, it is kind of job done, the warm-up game almost for Australia. But the other thing I think they've done, and they've done successfully, is they've certainly sent a message out to the rest of the teams of exactly what they're here to do. There's no compassion, there's no second gear. They're going to try and, you know, steamroll their way across every team that's put in front of them. Yes, they'll have harder games than they've had here today, but they've shown how versatile their game is on both ends of the floor.
Patrick Aquino waits, and Australia leave the court full of smiles. Philippines, meanwhile, try to regroup. And what do you think about these stats?
Yeah, the Philippines didn't start shooting the ball at all from the outside in the first half, and that's something I think they should have done, and I think you'll see through the tournament they do. But where Australia destroyed this game was on the boards. 70 rebounds to 19. I'm not sure I've ever seen a one-sided contest like that. And Australia will be happy as well. 41 assists for the 123 points. You know, that shows great team basketball, and that, you know, they're finding form and that they're in sync together already, even in this early stage of the tournament.
Well, McBeggar, I mean, it kind of felt like she was kind of in third gear today. She didn't really turn it up a notch. You just wonder what she could do. She had those 18 points. Miranda, of course, had the 15 in the first half of the Philippines. McBeggar had the three blocks. Bishop, Bernardino, Talbot all over the shop. Talbot with the four steals.
And this is the thing for Australia, you know, we talked about it. Every single player registered on the scoring today as well. And not only that, but they had, you know, numerous players in double digits. You're looking at eight players scoring double digits for Australia.
Well, now we're going to look back at some of the highlights and, I guess crucially for these teams, you know, what comes next? Australia, New Zealand. That'll be an entertaining one. Always is when those two countries square off. Excuse me, China. Well, of course, New Zealand, China have to play before that today. But that game will be tomorrow, and Philippines will also have a game against China on Wednesday. So those games, that's going to be a tough ask, really, for New Zealand, I would suggest, and also the Philippines. But we'll see. We'll see how tough New Zealand come out, and maybe the Australians will stick around to scout it.
Yeah, I think New Zealand-Australia games, as much as form is important, and you know, you look on paper, I think there's an added level to that as well. Now, obviously, with the Oceania system being brought into the Asia Cup, it's an interesting place for them to be. And I think you'll see an interesting physical battle between those two. For the Philippines, it doesn't exactly get easier, does it? They now face off against China. They get a good night's sleep behind them before they have to face what most people would see as one of the top four teams in this Asia Cup tournament.
So who, in your opinion, was the standout player for Australia? We know that statistically, McBeggar really racked up the numbers today.
Yeah, it's. Do you know what? You could look at all the way across their roster for different things. You had Mitchell, who was facilitating at times. You had the likes of O'Hay, who had a great high-efficiency performance as well. She was shooting 83% from the field. But then you've got people like Bishop and Allen, 11 points apiece. And, you know, so many big players stepped up. The one that I think we'll look forward to for the rest of this week and will be integral to whether Australia can stand on the top of the podium is going to be Kayla George. She had a great game, 11 points, 14 rebounds. For her, she only played 16 minutes. That's great. She's going to get some rest. She's not playing the usual amount that we'd expect in the bigger games, but she certainly had a big game here today.
Well, you mentioned at one point Mitchell doing a great job. She only had 5 points, but she had 9 assists. So that was nice opening game for her. And Steph Talbert quietly was 11 points, 6 assists, 4 rebounds. Australia rolled to a big victory over the Philippines.